Yes, today I'm going to continue the last class, that is Vibrio. In the previous class, I explained the classification of Vibrio, that is a brief explanation about the classification. In the past, they are classified based on the motility, oxidase positive, GERD bacteria. Later on, they were grouped the bacteria based on the fermentation of the mannose, sucrose, arabinose into eight groups. This cholera vibrio belongs to the group 1. And next followed that the classification is the serological classification, that is Gardner and Venkatraman classification. Here the cholera and other vibrios possessing the similar, which possess the similar H antigens, they are grouped under group A, and others which are having heterogeneous are collected under group B. Again, based on the somatic antigens, this group A had classified into subgroups. Subgroups almost till 139. From 1 to 139. Based on the clinical manifestations and biochemical species differences, they are again classified into two biotypes. They are ALTAR and classical biotypes. Based on minor somatic antigens, these ALTAR and classical again classified into Ogawa, Inaba, and Hikazuma serotypes. These Ogawa, Inaba serotypes are agglutinated by their own specific sera, whereas Hikozuma can be agglutinated by both these Ogawa and Inaba because of the presence of common A antigen. Besides this, vibrios which are not agglutinable with this woven antiserum, they are classified as non-woven vibrios. Here these are designated as non-agglutinating vibrios. After that, this Gardner's classification, further classification is based on FAST typing. These FAST typing schemes have been standardized for both classical and ALTAR biotype as well as for the O139 vibrios. Finally, molecular methods are involved, like ribotyping methods were introduced for further strain typing. This is about the classification of vibrio, brief explanation. And this is the table showing the differences between the classical and ALTAR vibrio. This ALTAR vibrio can be differentiated based on the hemolysis and sheep blood agar and box prosker is positive in case of ALTAR. Chick embryo agglutination is positive in case of ALTAR, and it is also susceptible to the ALTAR FAST5. Here, this classical vibrio is classical cholera vibrio is sensitive to the polymyxin B, and it is susceptible to the group 4 FAS. This is the table showing the difference between the classical cholera and ALTAR vibrio. And if you see the antigenic structure, this vibrio cholera contains its stable flagellar antigen. It is present in almost all vibrios. It is not protective. Whereas this vibrio cholera has somatic antigen like endotoxin, that is O-lipopolysaccharide, that confers only serological specificity. That means it shows a specificity to the classical cholera biotype ALTAR type with Ogawa serotype, ALTAR biotype with Ogawa serotype like that. It shows some serological specificity and also produces the specific antibodies. Here almost all here we have 139 O antigen groups, and Vibrio cholera O1 group and O group 139 causes cholera, classical cholera, whereas non Vibrio cholera produces the cholera like illness. The most important structure that is present in Vibrio cholera is H antigen and O antigen. And next important topic, that is cholera. This cholera is caused by Vibrio cholera. Species is Vibrio cholera. Here we have so many species are there, like Parahaemolyticus, Vulpicus, and Alginolyticus. So many species are there in Vibrio. In that, this cholera is mainly caused by Vibrio cholerae. Next, here this cholera is characterized or presented as acute diarrheal illness. Acute diarrheal illness typically presents as profuse, watery, painless diarrhea and copious, effortless vomiting, which may lead to the hypovolemia and shock within 24 hours. Next, here this cholera stool typically presents as watery fluid with mucus flux, and it also resembles water in which rice has been washed. So that's why it is also called rice water stool. The stool is rich in sodium bicarbonate, electrolytes, and little protein. And the severity of illness depends upon the. It may vary from mild to abrupt, sudden, massive diarrhea. Also, whereas this mild and asymptomatic, mild or asymptomatic cases are usually caused by ALTAR biotype. Okay, and clinical features of severity depends upon the massive loss of fluid and electrolytes. The common complication that we can see here is like muscle cramps, abdominal pain, pulmonary edema, next renal failure, cardiac arrhythmias, paralytic illness also. Here the picture showing the patient has a sunken eyes due to massive loss of the fluid. Okay, the patient may excrete almost 20 to 30 liters per day. Next, if you see the incubation period, it may vary. In severe cases, we can see the symptoms. It may vary from 1 to 5 days. In asymptomatic, the clinical symptoms may begin as mild diarrhea and vomiting. In some cases, it may present as abrupt, rapid, massive diarrhea. The mode of infection is mainly due to the fecal oral route. Mode of fecal oral route is the main mode. Whenever the patient ingests contaminated food or water, they may get the infection. But in humans, gastric acidity acts as a barrier to prevent the minimal dose of the infection. It also has been explained, like for example, infected dose 10 power 6 bacilli. Patient 10 power 6 bacilli, it is administered to the person who are under fasting, he won't get the infection because of the high acidity nature of the stomach. If it is administered along with food or with sodium bicarbonate, the disease can be seen. At almost about 80 to 100%. Okay, and this also had been explained by taking so many animal models. One of the important model is D.N. Chatterjee. They used the ligated rabbit ileum injected with this culture filtrate of the embryo. The result is there is a ballooning of the loop had been observed. The virulent factors that are mainly involved are the toxins that is produced by the bacteria, embryo bacteria, and also other factors like TCP, that is toxin adhesion factor. Special vibria, toxin co-regulated virus. Some enzymes are also involved for penetration of the vibrio. Penetration of the vibrio into the epithelial cell. Next, here the cholera is mainly due to the production of the enterotoxin, that is cholera toxin by the vibrio. This is determined by the filamentous phase, which is attached to the bacterial chromosome. This cholera toxin is also called enterotoxin, which resembles like heat level toxin of the Escherichia coli toxin, enterotoxin. It resembles in features like biologically and chemically also, but it is somewhat more potent when compared to the Escherichia heat level enterotoxin. Here this can be destroyed at 56 degrees centigrade in 30 minutes, and molecular weight weighs at about 84,000. It contains this cholera toxin contains the structure of the cholera toxin contains two subunits. There are A subunit, one A subunit and 5 B subunits. Okay. Here this B subunit is attached to the ganglioside receptors, whereas this A subunit transported into the epithelium, and this A2 links the biologically active A1 to the B subunit. Here we can see the mechanism of the cholera toxin, how it is responsible for the loss of fluid, like diarrhea, here this biologically active A1 prolongedly activates the adenylate cyclase. So there is an increased production of the CAM. It may lead to the outpouring of the heavy amount of water along with bicarbonate proteins and electrolytes, which may poured out into the intestinal lumen. and it also inhibits the absorption of the sodium and chloride. The severity of the this cholera depends upon the mainly is due to the loss of fluid and also the electrolytes. And this cholera toxin, cholera toxin shows some biological activities which is useful for the detection and its estimation. Here it can be detected by using some testing methods like lipolysis of the testicle of the rabbit and elongation of the Chinese hamster ovary. Next, other tests are also available, and it also sometimes acts as a skin permeability factor. That's why skin permeability. That's why it is also called permeability factor. It can be detected by skin gluing test. And other methods are also available, like ELISA. Okay, ELISA test is also available. This cholera toxin induces the antibodies. Induces the neutral antibodies. They are also called neutralizing, which is responsible for the neutralization of the toxin. So it can be because it is an antigenic in nature. So it can be toxicated. Next comes the epidemiology of the Vibrio cholera. If this cholera it is previously this cholera vibrio is confined to the India only till earliest of the 19th century. Because India consists of highly deltaic regions in the river of Ganga and Brahmaputra, which is present in the Bengal. Earliest of the 19th century, before and earliest of the 19th century, is confined to the Indian continent, India, and it is confined only to the India. And it produced so many epidemics before that period. After that, during the period of 1817 and 1923, in between these periods, six pandemics had occurred because of the classical biotype, and it reached and it spreads to and it spreads almost all over the world. Next pandemic, that is the seventh pandemic, that is seen at the time of 1961. The important feature of this seventh pandemic is this seventh pandemic originated outside the Indian subcontinent. And that means it is originated in Celebes and Indonesia. Not only that, it showed some differences also with that of the classical biotype. Like this, it is less severe when compared to the classical type. And less severe, and it originated outside the country. Next, mortality rate is low, carrier rate is very high in this case, seventh pandemic. After that, it surrounded the world, and 1991, it reached Peru. In almost 30 years, it had covered the globe. In 30 years, it had covered the globe. After that, this Altair Biotech, during the period of 1992, eighth pandemic had occurred. This eighth pandemic is mainly due to the non-woven, that is non-agglutinating Vibrio, and it is differentiated from Altair Biotech more severe when compared to the Altair by Altair Biotech. When compared to the Altair, it is more severe, and it also caused epidemics, also large number of epidemics throughout the world. After that, this non-woven eighth pandemic was first isolated in Madras. After that, a significant emergence of another strain was observed. That is in 1993 due to the O-139 that to be originated from the Bengal. At that period, as it contains novel surface antigens, so the human doesn't contain any antibody to this O-139 because of the presence of newer surface antigens. So at that time, it may produce another pandemic in coming years. At the time, they considered like that. But luckily, this Altair Biotech regained its dominance in 1994. This O-39 was diminished. I mean, at the time it was diminished. Nowadays, this Altair Biotech and classical biotech coexist in different parts of our country. So this Altair Biotech is harder than the classical biotech, but it causes less severe clinical manifestations when compared to the classical cholera. This is about the epidemiology of the Vibrio cholera. Here, cholera shows seasonal distribution in Bangladesh. It is usually seen in November, February, and Calcutta is usually seen in March and May because of the presence of the deltaic areas. And this epidemic cholera is also seen or associated with phase festivals or a large group of association of the peoples. This cholera Vibrio it causes only human infection. The natural reservoir is only the humans. But nowadays it presents in the saline water or brackish waters, or is associated with the seawater fishes, planktons, and crabs. So incubation period is almost 1 to 5 days. Conventional period is 2 to 3 days. In healthy individuals, clinical manifestation is seen up to 10 days. In chronic carriers, it can exist almost 10 years, that to be in the gallbladder. So, this is about the epidemiology. And while coming to see the laboratory diagnosis of this Vibrio cholera, this laboratory diagnosis not only used for the patient treatment, but also used for the epidemiological purposes also. The specimens that we collect are the stool sample. mainly the stool sample. Best sample is the stool sample that to be taken before the administration of the antibiotics. Okay, before the administration of these antibiotics. The best collection of the sample in active cases is by introducing the lubricating catheter into the rectum, catheter into the rectum, and it is collected into the wide screw capped container, and the stool is let it down into the screw capped container. This is the best collection of the sample. Next one is rectal swabs. These rectal swabs may be used when it is provided with good quality of the cotton. Cotton, like it should absorb 0.1 to 0.2 ml of the stool. These rectal swabs are usually taken in the patients who are taken in the convalescent period or from the convalescent carriers. Vomit is rarely useful for identification of this Vibrio cholerae. Next, if you see the processing, after receiving this sample, processing should be done before reaching to the laboratory. As this organism dies in tropical countries, it should be carried out in the transport medium. So the transport medium that are commonly used are Cariblair medium, VK medium, Mecatraman, Ramkrishna medium can be used for transport, and it is preserved at 4 degrees centigrade. Okay. After that, it should be taken to the laboratory. Sometimes enrichment media also can be used, like alkaline peptone water. So, for rapid diagnosis, microscopy can be used. Here, the motility of the vibrios can be motility under the microscope. Motility of the vibrios and its inhibition is used for its identification by using the antiserum. By using the antiserum of the antiserum with the microscopes like dark field or phase contrast microscopes. Before direct plating, as it reaches the laboratory, the stool which is inoculated in the enrichment media should be in the lab. It should be incubated 6 to 8 hours before plating, or if it transported with the transport, or if it is when it came along with the if it comes with the transport media, this sample is inoculated into the enrichment media, and again this enrichment media is incubated for 6 to 8 hours before plating. Sometimes direct plating is also suggested, and that to be bedside plating is more accepted. So the plates that are commonly used, different laboratories will use different types of media, but commonly used media are bile salt agar and non-selective media like non-selective media like meconium, and enriched media like blood agar. 5% blood agar. And selective media like TCBS and this GDTA media. Glucose, taurocholate, tryptase, stearate, agar. These two are the selective media. After plating, I want to show. This is the picture showing the rice water diarrheal sample. on your right side. And this is the picture showing the transport media, Wikipedia, VR media and Carry Blade media. Here the Mekanki on your left side media agar plate showing the Mekanki agar shows late lactose. Here this Vibrio calera forms the late lactose fermentation. And the right side picture, upper right side picture showing the bladaga with colonies which are caused a hemodigestion. And the below picture showing the TCBS media. Here this the TCBS media showing the yellow colored colonies. This TCBS is nothing but a selective media. You see the any yellow colored colonies on TCBS, you can say the stool sample contains the Vibrio cholerae. And next comes the biochemical reactions. Told in the previous class also, carbohydrate metabolism is fermentative, producing acid but no gas, and ferments the glucose, mannitol, maltose, mannose, sucrose, but not the inositol, arachidonose, or lactose. But here it has late lactose. On further incubation, I will see the fermentation of the lactose also. It forms a late lactose. Indole is formed. Are nitrates are reduced to nitrite. These two properties contribute to the cholera red reaction, which is an important point. Here, these are catalase, oxidase tests are positive, methyl red and urease tests are negative. Preliminary identification is mainly based on the Gram stain. Here, in the Gram stain picture, we can observe the curved rod shaped Gram negative bacteria. Under motility test, hanging preparation, we can observe the darting motility, and is an oxidase positive and catalase positive. Next, this Vibrio cholerae also can be identified by using the slide agglutination test. After observing the growth on the plates, select a colony which resembles the Vibrio cholerae, and it is agglutinated by using the oven antisedum. If it is positive, and do the biochemical reactions, and again do the biochemical reaction to differentiate the ALTAR biotype and this classical biotype. Next, further, these ALTAR biotypes, serotypes can be identified by using the serotyping to detect the Ogawa, Inaba, and serotypes. Next, I already told biochemical reaction for differentiation of this ALTAR and classical. And this serological diagnosis also can be done by using the agglutination tests and complement dependent vibrio antibodies or vibriocidal tests. Indirect hemagglutination test is also useful in this serological diagnosis. Here this serological diagnosis is mainly used for epidemiological purpose only. H antiserum is mainly used to know the non-agglutinating vibrios. After identifying these strains, we have to send the sample to the international reference center for phenotyping at the National Institute of Cholera and Enteric Diseases, which is present in the Kolkata. This is about the laboratory diagnosis. And if you see the immunity, it shows local immunity and systemic immunity. This immunity is is induced mainly by bacteria and toxin, where they multiply and elaborate the toxins near the intestine, small intestine and epithelium. Antibodies that are produced in the small intestinal lumen is copra antibodies. This consists of IgG, IgM and IgA. But these antibodies doesn't protect systemically. And if you see the prophylaxis, this prophylaxis includes by taking the general measures, by providing the safe water supply, proper disposal of human feces, and proper improvement of the environmental sanitization. These are some of the general measures that we have to take to prevent the cholera, cholera. Next, but these are these general measures is somewhat used only some part only, but other methods are also used. They are using the vaccines, like killed vaccine, killed or live vaccines. Killed vaccine contains 8,000 millions of Vibrio cholera per ml, which contains equal volume of the Ugawa and Inaba. These can be given subcutaneously or intradermally, but this parenteral route doesn't protect any local immunity, and at the same time they are reactogenic also. So these are not that much recommended. Next, oral vaccines are also available. They are killed oral wholesale vaccine with or without inclusion of B subunit of cholera toxin, and other vaccines, live oral vaccine, that is classical LTAR and U139 with the toxin genes deleted. This is a somewhat useful, but doesn't give any promising results. An ideal vaccine is yet to be found for cholera. Treatment, the main treatment is symptomatic treatment, that is replacement of fluids and electrolytes. Previously, before 1971, tetracycline is used for reduction of excretion of this bacilli. But after that, multi-drug resistant strains were evolved. Next, this Vibrio cholera. Besides this, we have non-agglutinating vibrios are also there. They causes the cholera like illness. This severity is not that much more. It causes a mild or severe diarrhea, resembles cholera like illness. And sometimes it also causes human lesions on the skin. But in some cases, it may penetrate the epithelium, invades the epithelium, and enters into the blood, causes the septicemia and meningitis also. Next, till now we had discussed halotolerant Vibrio. This is nothing but Vibrio cholerae. Halotolerant means it survives only in the presence of 0.1 to 0.5 concentration of the sodium chloride. This Vibrio mimicus is also halotolerant. It almost resembles Vibrio cholera regarding features like biochemical and also growth in the presence of 0.5 to 1% sodium chloride, but it can be differentiated by sucrose fermentation. Whereas here it is sucrose doesn't fermented. Here the sucrose is fermented, and infection is mainly due to the ingestion of the seafood, particularly associated with oysters, and clinical manifestations resembles the Vibrio parahemolyticus. Yeah, these are the Vibrio cholera and Vibrio mimicus are both are tolerant, and this next species are halophilic vibrios. Why these are called halophilic vibrios? Because these can survive even in the presence of the high concentration of the sodium chloride. So their natural habitat is seawater and marine life. The so many species are there, but they are not all important. Here three species are causing human lesions. They are Vibrio parahemolyticus, Alginolyticus, and Vulnificus. These three are important. Here, this Vibrio parahemolyticus was observed during 1951, which caused gastroenteritis in Japan people who had taken contaminated sea fish contaminated with the sea fish. It also may be due to crabs contaminated with this Vibrio parahemolyticus, prawn, shrimps, and seafood here. This is a halophilic, grow in the presence of 8% sodium chloride. And another differentiating feature is it is a capsulated one. It's a capsulated and it shows bipolar staining. And meconic agar, it shows non-lactose fermenting. And blood agar, it shows hemolysis. And TCBS, growth is green in color. Here in Vibrio cholera, on TCPS, it showed yellow colored colonies, whereas Vibrio parahemolyticus growth is red in color, green in color with raised opaque with raised top and translucent edges. And sometimes it shows pleomorphism also. It shows pleomorphism in boat culture. And sometimes it shows peritracheous flagella on solid media and polar flagella when it grows in the liquid media. Here, its sting test is positive, and is oxidase, catalase, indole, and citrate are positive, reduces nitrates to nitrates. This Vibrio parahemolyticus contains three antigenic components. They are O, K, and H. K indicates the capsule. Again, this Vibrio parahemolyticus classified and recognized 12 O groups and 59 distinct K serotypes. 59 K serotypes, 12 O groups contain distinct 59 K serotypes. Not all these Vibrio parahemolyticus produces the pathology in humans. Only some strains only causing the human infections. Here, this parahemolyticus produces the produces the heat label hemolysin, produces heat stable hemolysin, which indicates the Kanagawa phenomenon. When the inoculum is plated on the hyoscyamoid blood agar, it shows hemolysis. It is due to heat stable hemolysis. If you see any hemolysis, it indicates that the stain that was grown is pathogenic. If it is not hemolytic, the stain that was grown was not the stain that was grown is not pathogenic. This is nothing but the Kanagawa phenomenon or Kanagawa positive strain. Pathogens, if you see the pathogens, yes, food poisoning is mainly due to the ingestion of the marine food. Here the enterotoxin doesn't have any role. Pathogens is mainly due to the invasion of the bacteria, thereby causing the explosive diarrhea, abdominal cramps, vomiting, fever. These are the usual signs. Now, sometimes it may cause wound infection, ear or eye infection when they are exposed to the contaminated water. Dehydration is moderate. And next one is Vulnificus. This is another halophilic vibrio. It is also infection is also due to the ingestion of the seawater, which is associated with the shellfish. It may cause two types of infection, that is wound infection and septicemia. Wound infection is mainly due to the ingestion of the infected shellfish. The septicemia is mainly due to the ingestion of the raw esters. Here, this is non-sucrose fermenter, but it ferments the lactose. Next one is the next halophilic vibrio is Aljunolyticus. Is also caused due to the contact of seawater or ingestion of the seafood. Yeah, this Vulnificus grows only in the presence of 8% sodium chloride. More than that, it won't grow. But here, this Aljunolyticus will grow even in the presence of 10% sodium chloride. Here also, it shows yellow color colonies on TCBS. And another important feature is it grows as swarming. And infection is mainly seen in immunocompromised patients. Sometimes in normal individuals, it can be observed in eye, ear, or wound infections. This is the table showing the difference between the Vibrio parahemolyticus and Aljunolyticus. Besides the genus Vibrio, we have other genuses in the family Vibrionaceae. They are Eromonas and Mesomonas. Only some species are causing the human creatures, like Eromonas hydrophila. This isolated from the frogs caused red leg disease and diarrhea also, and diarrhea in some cases. Pyogenic illness are also seen in another genus is Plesiosomonas shiguloides. It causes diarrheal disease. It is oxidase positive and polar flagellated. It can be we have to differentiate these Eromonas and Plesiosomonas by using the utilization of the amino acids. This completes the Vibrio. Thank you.